That is on last week.
Okay, I'm going to start, guys, okay? So, the first thing I have to say is that I was completely fooled into doing this. Okay? Because Peter comes to me and says, "What do you think about us doing a gardening class?" And I said, "Wow, great idea!" And all of a sudden, I'm doing the gardening class. And I go, I don't think this was the goal. I don't know how this happened, but I was tricked. So I decided, like, you know, Beth here has 35 years of experience gardening, so I'm not sure what I'm doing here, because this is my second year gardening, okay?
Already gotten.
But the thing is, like, you know, if you want to learn from someone that just started, you know, sometimes if you don't have as much experience, that's, you can relate to what other people are suffering. So a little bit about me. I was raised in Portugal, living in apartments. That's the only life I ever knew. I'm one of those persons, or maybe, let's say, I used to be one of those persons that if you asked me, where do you want to live, I would say New York, San Francisco. Not in a place with a backyard or animals or no, nothing like that. And it was funny because we were living in Clovis, and I wanted to stay in Clovis, but we wanted to buy a house. And my husband wanted a house with a backyard, okay, to play soccer with his kid. He played once. But we bought a house with a backyard. And this was the house. So in the beginning when we bought the house, so the house was like this. This is our cat. He's everywhere. And it was just volcanic rock everywhere. And we didn't like how it looked. So we decided, let's change our backyard. So this is how it is. You know, my husband is always taking pictures. And I hate the fact that he's always taking pictures. But for this presentation, I said, thank you. Because you're always, because now it looks more like this. But I'm going to show you pictures. So this was the beginning, you know. You used to have a long patch of grass here. And my cat started having a reaction to the grass. And I go, like, the cat doesn't like the grass. They don't play soccer. Let's let that thing die, right? Let's kill the thing. Everywhere it was just volcanic rocks. So we decided, okay, let's start by planting some trees here, okay? Some ornamental trees. And one of the trees that I love the most is an Oklahoma red bud that we have here at the church. I don't know if you have noticed, is one that when it comes spring, it's full of red buds. Just small red buds, it's beautiful. So I said, I want one of those trees. And Daniel says, okay. So this was what, see, it was volcanic rock. The only good thing is if there was someone trying to rob my house, I would hear them trying to come in. Because that thing, it was was horrible. It was terrible like that. So my husband said, okay, I'm gonna plant two trees. So he planted, he wanted to plant them in the extremes of the fence, by the fence. And I say, oh, since you're gonna plant the trees, why don't you use the Ellen G. White method? And it's also known as the angel method. And it's the fact that when she was in Australia, she was trying to plant trees and they would all die. So she, in the night she had a dream and an angel came to her and told her how to plant trees. And there is a specific method like how to do it. It's digging a
3 feet by 3 wide.
Yeah. And you put a million things inside. If you ever want to know how to do that, he's very good at it. But oh my gosh, he almost died doing.
They even put like rocks on the bottom of it.
Rocks.
One of the layers.
Yeah. So he did all of that. And I'm gonna tell you, these trees are doing awesome because we were so very good at this that we planted them the wrong time of the year.
Yeah.
All of that, and they survived, and they are growing, and they are looking beautiful. So when we went to the nursery to choose the trees, I saw strawberries, and because I don't understand any of this, I bought a pot to put my strawberries, okay? And I said, okay, we're gonna have strawberries during the summer. And I saw some marigold. Then another pastor gave us some some eggplants, and I have to tell you that they all died. This was my first attempt, okay? So my motto is fail forward, okay? That's how you do it, okay? So a little bit later, the strawberries start growing. And I go, okay, the strawberries won't fit in those little things, so let's buy a raised bed. And then I go. If I'm gonna buy a raised bed, I buy two, right? One, so it's not enough. So I decided to buy a second one. See, here, still a lot of volcanic rock. And I said, okay, I'm gonna plant tomatoes. So I start planting tomatoes. Tomatoes were terrible last year. They all, because the temperatures went very high, very fast, and after, when the temperatures are above 90 degrees, the tomatoes stop producing flowers. So everyone that planted tomatoes last year, I don't know if it happened to you.
Oh yeah,
but
it was a horrible year.
So fail forward, you know, you'll learn. Then my husband continued, because he is good at this. See, he started putting mulch on the ground. See, here they were still alive, but because I was so smart, I left the volcanic rock under the raised bed. So I got to a point that the roots could not grow anymore, so the plants all died. They all died. So he continued doing our backyard. See, these were my potatoes. I have to tell you about my potatoes. They were here. I planted two potatoes, okay? That's what I did. And grow bags, yes. So look at the strawberries. You saw how the strawberries were? So this was like 3 months later. Wow. This is a strawberry bed.
Nice.
It was huge. And here we had a lemon, Meyer lemons tree in a pot. Because you know, I like everything very organized. So I'm not a person that will plant one thing here and let it grow and go crazy. Everything has to be contained. And that's why people say, oh, it looks so cute, your backyard. So my husband continued, like the tomatoes. I had a lot of green all summer, but very few tomatoes. You know when I got my tomatoes? In October. I had so many tomatoes in October. But by then we went so fast from summer to winter that they were all green, you know? So we can look, this was later in the year. The tomatoes just grow like crazy. And by this time I was completely addicted. Let's see what else can I grow, right? So this was like this. I had a potato this size, okay? Tiny potato. And it was sprouting like the potatoes she has here. There are a few there. And what I did is I'm gonna put it in dirt. And I did in a grow bag this size. Here, this is where it is. And that small potato gave me 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 potatoes. And no work, nothing. This is awesome.
Yeah.
You plant one and you get six, this is like Christmas, right? And it's so cool because then you have to dig to find them. And oh, one more, I love it. And I use, you know, people say that they have brown thumbs. I had like a black. It was, I would kill everything. I have a friend that once gave me a succulent and I said, please don't, I'm gonna kill it. And I killed it so fast. I would kill everything. Peter.
Cynthia, when did you start your potatoes?
I think I started in April, which is not the right time. And I got the, again, wrong time. That's why I brought you this thing, because this thing is specific for the Central Valley, okay? If you want to plant potatoes, you should be planting them in January and then in October or November, okay? But I did mine in April because, you know, at this point, I'm just trying, right, to see if things survive or if they die. And even so, in July, I had potatoes, so it's possible. Even when you do it wrong, it's possible to get. Then I go, oh no, now I have to plant flowers, right? Am I gonna let them survive? Again, I bought hydrangeas, the worst plant to have in Fresno. And I plant them, like, not in the shade, the place, like sun. And then I But this, if there's a plant you want a flower that you want to try to buy, they're called Supertunias Vista Bubblegum. They do this. If you plant this, you will fall in love with flowers. They usually have them at Home Depot or Lowe's in April, beginning of April. It's like $5, thing like this, very small, and it does this. I'm gonna show another picture to you. And it's beautiful, it's beautiful. This is my husband, very proud of our backyard. Of course, did you see the hammock here? This year in the winter, I go, I don't like the hammock there, two more raised beds. So now we have two other raised beds there. And he says, I'm gonna let you do whatever you want, because by the end of our life here in this house, the whole backyard will be filled with, and he's probably right. So now in the winter, what did I do? So people say that it's very hard to grow tulips here. Okay, so I said, I know I'm gonna grow tulips because if it's possible, I'm gonna do it. So the two trees that I have 30 tulips around them. And they're beautiful. I just kept them in the fridge for 12 weeks. That's the trick here. I have oregano. I brought oregano for you guys to smell to see the difference. You can take a little bit and just around your fingers to see, you know, but to see the difference between the store-bought and, because I have my own oreganos and then I dry them and I use them to cook. It's completely different. I have parsley, I have cilantro. Now I'm doing, you know what I did? Who knows what this is? Garlic.
Yeah, garlic.
Oh, I'm planting garlic. Let's see
what. When did you plant your garlic?
Where?
Where?
When? I'll tell you afterwards. October. I don't know. October or November.
May?
Mm-hmm. What, does it say May? It depends. Because they're usually for these types of vegetables, there are two seasons that you can plant them. But I think I did. I have a spreadsheet with all the dates. And I don't know if you, do you remember this place? So we put some cement and then we bought it like a trellis on Amazon. And we have fava beans growing and peas. Because we love fava beans, because it's very hard to find fava beans here, fresh fava beans. In our country, it's something that we eat a lot. So those are snow peas and fava beans, and they are growing. But I already learned that's probably not the best place to have them. So again, fail forward, right? And this winter, I had lettuce the whole winter. This is Portuguese cabbage here growing. These are already dying. These are leeks. I learned my lesson. Leeks take forever. It takes like 8 months for leeks to grow. Another thing that I planted and I'm not going to plant again is cauliflower. Because that thing takes like, I don't know, 8 months?
Wow.
One thing that I planted the whole winter and I'm going to plant even more next winter is bok choy. 30 days. You plant bok choy, that thing grows anywhere, and you have greens all winter long. It's amazing.
And you can do bok choy continually.
Couldn't you?
You don't have to wait till winter, you can plant it now.
Yeah. Bok choy is that. So see my flowers? So if you want to fall in love with gardening, buy those flowers.
Those are the Supertunia?
Yeah, Supertunia Vista Bubblegum. And this is salvia. I have plants of salvia. And the contrast looks beautiful because the bark is black, so it looks very nice. So a little presentation. This is what I have to tell you, just a few tips, okay? First thing, start before you're ready. You know, these are the two things that I live my life by. It's always like that, you know? Sometimes we want to know everything about something, because we don't want to make a mistake as adults, right? But when we are kids, we just try, you know, and let's see what happens. But it's a gift when you start, you know, I started with strawberries. And then let's go with the raised bed. Now I have two raised beds. Let's plant something there. A lot of them died, you know? Just try and like learn. I was talking to Beth and she was saying, yes, becoming a gardener is a lifelong,
forever learning.
Forever learning. Yes, Peter.
Do you start your things from seeds?
Yes.
And then transplant?
I'm going to show it to you, yeah. Oh. First year, I only did the tomatoes because I didn't know better, but now I have a ton of seedlings and I have more at home. I'm going to show it to you. So what do you need? The benefits of gardening, right? It's a little bit like the benefits of microgreens, but it's outside. You know, you get fresh and healthy food because you know where your food is coming from, and it tastes so different. A strawberry from your backyard, a tomato from your backyard, it doesn't have the same taste. It doesn't. It's completely, the garlic, it's not the same thing. The lemons, it's completely different. It is the best exercise you can do. If you think about our beliefs as Seventh-day Adventists and the new start, being a gardener, you include all of them. All of them, right? You have the sunshine, you have the water, you move your body, you are planting, your sunlight produces vitamin D. Yes, Tim.
It actually helps your gut microbiome when you're gardening because it
touching the
helps you with your own gene system.
It does. It does. My work is very demanding, and last year I would get home and go to my backyard and stay there for an hour, talking to my plants, cutting them. My husband, knowing me, this is where I see that God has a very good sense of humor. We always think about God as a very serious person, but I think God has a very good sense of humor. Because if you were to tell me 3 years ago that I would be here talking to you about planting potatoes, you have issues. That will never happen. I'm not going to do that. I kill everything. I don't like it. And in a season, it was one season, God changed completely my heart regarding this, and now I love it. It's like therapy for me. You know, people pay a lot.
She wants a bigger backyard.
And like a few days ago, I was like, I think I would like chickens. And then he said, we need a bigger property because we're not going to have chickens in this neighborhood. Okay. Maybe it's not a good idea to have chickens in that neighborhood.
There's some neighbors that have.
Yeah, but you know, no one likes them. No one likes that neighbor.
No one likes them. Mad at you.
Sorry? No. We used a little bit to plant the first trees, but you know, gardening, this is what I think. Gardening can be as easy or as complicated as you want to make it, okay? Because you can test your soil, but you can do a ton of things. But because I'm growing everything in raised beds or in grow bags, I buy my soil. So I buy organic soil. This one is very, for me, I have, another thing you need to know about me is not that I'm cheap, I'm frugal. So these bags, they have 2 cubic feet and they cost $9. I love this. And it grows very well. It's organic. It's OMRI certified. It's very good. That's what I use for everything, because that's it. You can go as complicated as trying to amend your soil and adjust and
do
all of
that.
For the trees, we did. We amended the soil for the trees because it was in ground, right? But because I'm using raised beds, and the message I wanted to pass to you guys today is that it is as simple as some seeds, some grow bags, you know, a grow bag if you don't have space, and some dirt, and you start, and you fail forward, and that's all you need. I can talk a little bit about fertilizers and the right ones to use, but most, if you buy the soil already is fertilized, at least for 6 months. So you can do more on top of it, but as I said, this is for beginners. It's not for someone that has been doing this for 35 years. I'm sorry, always learning. Simplify, you know, because this is the thing. If you start complicating and you start thinking about, oh, I have to buy this, I have to buy that, I have to buy, it's very expensive and you give up, right? Very fast. Peter?
Well, as far as being very expensive, I spend a lot of time on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
And I ran across this one, growing stuff in cardboard boxes.
Mm-hmm.
You want to make sure that they're just round cardboard boxes, and you have to, if you're going to use it organically, you take all the tape off, because mm-hmm. you can take the cardboard box and when it deteriorates and put it in the soil. Earthworms love that.
Yeah.
And that's cheap. And then you use the when I put the potatoes in,
compost?
One website said use worm castings.
Worm castings.
So you put about an inch of that over that. And with the potatoes, some people say, well, you just cut them up wherever they have an eye. Well, they don't grow that way because they use the potato for food. The plant uses the actual potato for food.
If you leave a chunk, like if it's a potato very
it
big,
about one
and
ounce.
Yeah, if you cut in half. Like that one, I wouldn't cut in half.
Yeah.
But if you have an eye on each extreme,
and when you plant with the,
you can cut
with
it
the
in
eyes
half.
Up, because
yes.
the roots grow up mm-hmm. and not down.
The right.
I thought it was rather interesting.
Yes.
Then I ran into this other site.
Because those, yeah, because
they recommend sardines.
Mm-hmm.
So I went to a dollar store, and they got sardines in brine or sardines in water. Well. Lately, all you can find are they're in tomato juice or something else, so I went and got sardines.
Yeah, so that's why I use fish fertilizer.
Mm-hmm.
This already stinks. The sardines would be too much.
Good smell.
He was going to cut but he's the one that did the sunshine mix number 4. He says for those that, you know, some
as a fertilizer?
Yeah.
Okay.
They don't want certain things in the soil. So he says get some at Lowe's, go and get sunshine mix number 4.
Yeah. You know, it's. The only. And since we're talking about fertilizers, I can put it here now. The only thing I don't do is a lot of people will use Miracle-Gro. Okay. Mm-hmm. This is synthetic, this is not organic. Okay. I use this for my hanging baskets. You saw them? Because
mm-hmm.
they make the flowers look beautiful, and I'm not going to eat the flowers. And that this is not going into my soil because it's on top of concrete, right? So I use it because it makes them beautiful. But if I'm growing something to eat or if I have flowers with my veggies, I will use something organic because you will end up eating it. So whatever you feed the soil, whatever you feed the plants, it comes back into your body. So I have this, but this only goes on my plants, flowers and things like that, or home, you know, house plants, things that are contained. It's not wrong, you know, it's not something that, but it's synthetic, it's not natural.
I just want to say for anybody who wanted to get really cheap, you said frugal, E&J Winery, they have like a bunch of, like, you can go and get truckloads of compost, potting soil, potting mix, all that stuff, so cheap. I think $22 for a truckload, and like I don't have a truck, so I just come with my little, you know, those 5 gallon Home Depot buckets, and
bag.
I just shovel as many
yep.
as I can, and they only charge me
$11
Just don't use. Just don't. The only thing I would draw the line is using compost from Central Valley Disposal because that's human waste.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna go there. Yeah. You know?
Yeah,
so that one I wouldn't.
That, but I know it's cheap. You know that, so.
But if it's like if they are gardening and they create, I would love to start my compost, but my husband says no. So he has to buy me a bigger property.
Do it in a trash can.
Yeah,
do it in a trash can.
I know,
no
but
smell.
It says it's going to stink.
No,
it doesn't stink,
no,
right?
It does not
stink.
See, tell him.
You can come. And we've had one, and we're not really gardeners. My sister gave us one. It's been like 15 years. We keep putting stuff in there, and it never fills up.
And never stinks.
No, it doesn't stink.
See, that's if it's done properly and if you move the things around. I'm gonna. Next time we do this, I'll have a compost.
Or a bigger problem.
Well, we know what to get her for her birthday.
Kathy was mentioning buckets you get from Home Depot and everything. you turn the bucket over, there's a triangle in it. Mm-hmm. If there's a two in it, it's food grade.
Okay.
And some people, you can do an earthworm farm with three buckets, but you want to make sure that whatever you're using are food grade.
Yes.
And that you haven't had paint in it or
of course.
You know, oil or, you know, that they're brand new. Mm-hmm.
Your soil, where did you get it from?
This is from Lowe's.
Oh, Lowe's.
It's like $9. And these grow bags, if you buy them on Amazon, 10 of these sizes. These are the ones that I use for potatoes and for onions, for root vegetables. And these cost $25, 10. So it's, and it, you know, this is good for 5, 6, 7 years if you take care of them. So for me, like, if you want to start something, like, for example, you have potatoes, you want to start something, a grow bag like this, a few bags of dirt, and start. Just start, you know? You're going to fail, but fail forward. You know that next year, you'll have to change something, you know? So what do you need, okay, to start gardening? You need a suitable location. So you need at least 6 to 8 hours of sunlight daily, okay? So choose a place in your backyard. Mine is sunlight every hour of the day, and probably, you know, I don't have big trees, so I don't have that problem. But of course, if you have a big tree, don't put a tomato plant under the big tree, because the tomatoes are not gonna like. Tomatoes, basil, eggplants, peppers, they like the sun. They don't like the temperatures above 90, but they like sun. You know, your basil will be beautiful in July, August. You know, it's going to be beautiful. Then it will bolt, and then you have more seeds. But it's beautiful, and it's excellent. Okay? So prepare your soil. Usually, the best way is, if you're starting, you know, understand this. This is for beginners. You can do the no-dig method, which is, some people do it. You just put cardboard on top of the soil you have now. And then you put the dirt on top of the cardboard, and you start planting like that. You know, eventually the cardboard will disappear, and the soil and the worms and everything will start taking care of your own soil. Okay, it will fix your own soil. The other options is raised beds. I love raised beds because you can start right away. You don't have to take care of your soil and then have your soil tested, and then grow bags. If you live in an apartment or if you have a small garden, grow bags, you can plant everything in them, and they are so nice. And another thing that you can explore if you have a small space is vertical gardening. Some people forget about that, but your walls, your fence, you can plant cucumbers, nasturtiums, fava beans, peas. Just you have more space than you think, you know. And that, if you saw that, it's just it's a little line that has squares, and you just, the plants grow, and then you can pick the fruits. Even small melons, you can do that. Cucumbers, zucchinis, you can do all of that. Just even, like, for example, you get a grow bag, and you can put a trellis here on your grow bag, and you let it grow, and you can do cucumbers and things like that.
I have some beautiful aloe vera plants. They decided to upgrade our complex. It's mostly seniors here, so they came in and they wanted to spray and paint everything. But they not only painted the building, they painted my aloe vera plants. You know, and so I thought, I can't grow. And then I had a little plant, and here comes a dog, and he decides, I'm like, I'm done.
Well, that's in the container.
I know, it's in the container.
Yes, and also, if you don't have a lot of sun, and you have the time and the patience, you can take your containers from one side, you know, during the day, like, then you exercise and you move them around. So I think those are the best ways to start, right? Of course, you have to have good access to water. I bought, for Christmas, my gift was a hose that is a standing hose, and I love my hose now, you know, for Christmas, me getting a hose.
What do you mean, stand?
Yeah, it's a hose link. It has a, you put it on a pole, and it doesn't touch the floor. So instead of you, you know, I don't
dragging
even know.
It. Instead of dragging it, you just pull it.
Yeah, so it's up. So
oh, okay.
The whole time.
It's not going to move the real hose. Yeah.
Just not to mess my bar.
That, yeah, I have to, his bark.
Mulch.
If you
do bark?
The
bark.
Mulch.
Bark.
Yeah.
So it's called a what again?
It's a hose link. That's what they call them.
Okay.
Okay. They're very nice and very good quality. And they, like, I love convenience. And then you just tug it and just, you leave it and you release it and it goes back to place.
Oh, okay.
So it stays neat. You know, organized again. That's my middle name, okay? Okay. So, what is important to know? Your growing zone. Here we are on zone 9B. So when we are watching YouTube, we have to be careful what we are watching, because the way we plant here is not going to be the same way people plant in Michigan. That's why I gave you those Central Valley. Like that, it gives you an idea. Because, for example, for us, we can put our tomato, like for example, I'm going to show you next. The most important thing you need to know, mainly for annuals, because you know you have perennials and annuals. Perennials are plants that go for more than one season. An example is asparagus, parsley, oregano. Those plants usually have two years. You know, the first year they produce a lot, then the second year they bolt. But what you really need to know for the tomatoes, the veggies that you plant annually, is your first frost and last frost.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So, for example, what did I wanted to say? So, for example, someone in Michigan, they won't plant their tomatoes out before May. Here, if the weather gets a little bit better, our tomatoes can go out on the 15th of March. So usually 2 weeks after the last frost, so it's going to be March the 15th, you can start planting frost tender plants. So plants that the frost would kill them, okay? And those are the cucumbers, the eggplants, the melons, all of those things, okay? So this is very important that you know. And the first frost is November 17th. So if you have tomatoes outside, basil, when it comes to around this date, this is not scientific, right? it will kill. The first frost will kill those plants.
Mm-hmm. So when you're saying you can put them out, do you mean you've already done the seeds, they've germinated, they're ready to go, and then you put them out? Or
yes.
Is that the time to put the seed in?
No, put them out. So this is a tomato. This is a green tomato, okay? So this green tomato, in a week or so, I can put it in the raised bed, okay, in the ground. Mm-hmm. Or if you're starting now, you can go buy the plant. The difference is that I love seeds. Why do I love seeds? Because I love them growing. They look so cute.
They're like your babies.
They're my babies. Mm-hmm. And then on top of that, you pay $3 for a packet that has 50 seeds.
Mm-hmm.
And you go buy a tomato plant. I don't know. I think they are $6, $7 now, like a transplant. So I love seeds because of that, you know. And just to tell you, just to show you a good example, I was telling them that I believe in this very, very, very much, that when you, when a seed doesn't perform the way it should, it's not your problem. It's that the seed didn't have what it takes. It was not you, it was the seed. And I'm going to show you a fact. So this is the same, from the same packet, okay? So this one is this size, this one is this size. I didn't do anything wrong. I didn't doing anything different. But this seed doesn't want to live, you know? And that's probably what's going to happen. And you have to respect them, you know? So, for example, I'm planting dahlias, okay? The same thing, planted at the same time. Tell me, did I do anything wrong there in the same spot? doesn't have what it takes. It's not my problem. Okay? So I just want you to realize that it's okay to fail. And you're going to fail. I can guarantee that. Okay, so we have cool season crops, okay? And we have warm season crops. The cool season crops, you can plant them during that period after the first frost, so after November. They can be outside, okay? When do we start the seeds for those? Usually in August, okay? So if you guys are interested in the future, maybe at the end of August, we can come and just do a lot of seeds trays and take them home and then plant them in the garden after the first frost. Because if they are outside before the first frost, they will cook. So after the first frost. So what do we have? We have cauliflower. I'm not going to do that again. It takes forever. Cabbage. I have Portuguese cabbage. It's the cabbage that you saw in my pictures. Because we have a specific soup in Portugal that we make that has that cabbage. And I love it. And that's the only way. And that's the only thing I'm planting. And broccoli. I had a broccoli this year that instead of being that big head, it was like just florets. So it's a Chinese broccoli. So it has the head of the broccoli, and then the stem tastes like asparagus. So it keeps on going, coming. So the whole winter we went with bok choy and asparagus, and it was not enough. So next year we have to plant more. And if you want to feel like you are succeeding, go with bok choy. Make you happy, you know? And it's tasty, it's healthy, and it will make you happy, okay? Then we have the worm crops. What are the worm crops? Is the ones we are now going to put outside, okay? After the last frost, we're going to put them. The cucumbers, eggplants, peppers, tomatoes, zucchinis, there are a lot more, right? Melon, zucchini, corn, it's the majority of them we plant during the warm season that for us goes from March 1st until November 16th, okay? And everything you can imagine, pumpkins will grow during this time of the year.
We were in Washington State with by Walla Walla when we were first married, a couple years after we first married, and one of my husband's friends, the mother, grew so much sweet corn, it was like you couldn't hardly get into the house. And we had sweet corn three times a day.
It was so good.
It was so delicious. And it was amazing.
We had a bowl of sweet onions, were so sweet. You would eat just onion with peanut butter and eat it together.
That's like next level, right? That was my first one. Okay. So this year, I'm very much into this. Sometimes we think about gardening like this, okay? This is what we think about gardening, right? We have a row of lettuce, a row of tomatoes, you know, and because that's what we see the farmers doing, right? But we are wrong. If you think about nature, how do things grow? They don't grow like that, right? It's all scattered, all mixed. So this year I'm planting zinnias, dahlias, a ton of flowers, nasturtiums. I have black-eye Susans. I have physalis. I have celosia. I don't even know if I'm saying the names right because I know I'm Portuguese. I have echinacea. Yeah, I got it right. Rudbeckia. I have a ton of flowers and I want to do this. I want to do this. I want my garden to look like this. And this is perfect because first the smell of the flowers repels the bugs, you know, the pests. That's one of the things. And the second thing, it brings the pollinators.
Yes.
So the bees want to be with the flowers. And when they are with the flowers, they also pollinate your tomatoes and they pollinate your eggplants and they grow bigger and they look nicer. So this is my goal this year. I don't know if I'm going to get there, but this is my goal for this year.
The ones that smell a little bit are star jasmine because they could grow up.
Beautiful.
And also the gardenias.
Yes. I also have marigolds. I have a few here for you guys to look at. So The question you guys were asking, if I do seeds or seedlings. So seedlings is, it's like this, a little bit bigger, and it's like the plant is ready to go. It's a plant that goes, you buy at the store and you go and grow. Mainly, I love the seeds because my workstation at home is like, I have my computer, my second screen, and then I have my grow lights with all my trays, these trays, okay? So what I do is while I'm working, I talk with them. And we have a lot of fun today. And I see that they are growing, and for me, that's beautiful, you know? And what?
I said, they're such a good listener.
They are. And they never come to me. You know? And you know, I can tell them everything about my work, that I'm so mad at so many people, and then they just.
And Warren has ears.
Yes, you know? So, you know, here you have peppers and eggplants, and then I do this for them to become strong. So I'm just going crazy, right? For someone who wanted to live in San Francisco, you know? And one of the things that I love about growing from seed is the variety, okay? Because if you go to a store and you want to buy a tomato, you are going to buy a cherry tomato, a yellow tomato, you know? Something like that. The variety is not that big. There are hundreds of different types of tomatoes. You can grow purple tomatoes. You can grow white tomatoes. For example, one of my favorite eggplants that is so expensive here and I can never see, it's the one I have here. I have the seeds there. And it's purple with white stripes.
Yeah.
That is the best eggplant in the world. But you cannot buy a plant. I can't find a plant that has that eggplant. So I start from seed. And like that, I find the species, the variety that I want. It's more work, I have to say. It's more work, but it's lovely. It's lovely. Uncertainty, it's one of the problems. Like you saw, some of them don't like to grow. You know? It's their problem. And it's time consuming. The seedlings, you know, you buy, you have a limited variety, but you can put them in ground very fast, so it's not as time consuming as the rest. And just to end, the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed, and the Lord God took the man and put him into the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it.
Amen.
Amen. So just a few things if you guys want to look at. So fertilizers, I use this on almost everything, okay? When you look at a fertilizer, I'm getting to that phase of my life, you will see that they have, most of them will have nitrogen, phosphate, and potassium, okay? So you have to memorize, let's see if I say how to
sell.
NPK. Yeah, NPK, but it's, I forget, it's leaves, roots and flowers. So if you're trying to NPK, which is the three of them, right? Let's see, sometimes they have a bigger, they say it bigger, like NPK. But they have, most of them say NPK, and they have like this, look. This is a good example. This is the one I use in my houseplants. Do you see 111? So it means has the percentage that is in the fluid is one of nitrogen, one of phosphorus, and one of potassium, okay? What does that mean? It means that it will do the same thing for flowers, roots, for leaves, roots, and flowers. For example, if I look at this one, this is the crazy one. It has 24% of nitrogen, then it has 8% of phosphate and 16% of potash. They call it potash, I call it potash. There you go. So if I want to grow flowers, I want something that has a bigger number at the end. Okay? If I'm trying to grow leafy greens, I want something with a bigger number at the beginning. Okay. If I'm growing something that it's a root vegetable, like carrots or leeks, or well, you can think about all the root vegetables. I want something with a bigger number, okay? That's how you do it. Or you just use something like this and it's good for everything, and that's what I do. Then if I want to go a little bit more specific, you can buy something like this. These are very good. This is a very good brand. And this, look, I still have more than half, and I used all summer long. And it's called Tomato Tone. It's from Espoma, and it's specific for tomatoes. And it has also, it has colonies of bacteria that will help the roots. So you see, this one is a 3, 4, 6. The last one is all flowers and fruits, okay? So it has more. But the cool thing is this is, although it says it's for tomatoes, it helps all the plants that are like tomatoes. What plants are there? Are those? Are eggplants, peppers, tomatoes, what else? I have something.
Anything nightshade.
A nightshade.
Any of the nightshades, yeah.
You know, those are, and you can tell them apart because they usually have roots coming out. They are very tiny, but they have roots coming out of their stem as they are growing. For example, something that most people don't know is when you want to plant a tomato. So I'm going to let this one grow a little bit more and I'm going to move it to a bigger pot. But I can come here and take this leaf out and I plant it up to here. And you can see that it has a ton of hairs. And all these hairs that are around the tomato plant are going to become roots. Okay. So this is another type of tomato. This is one of those big red ones. So the stem is full of, what do we call this? Little spikes? I don't know. What? Hairs? It looks like hairs. So all these hairs have the potential of becoming roots. So when you want to plant your tomato, you just take the leaves at the bottom and you plant it as deep as you can, and all those, and that will make a bigger and better plant because it will grow more roots. And the same thing with the eggplants, the peppers. Another thing that I'm trying to grow, it's this plant here, and it's a ground cherry. I don't know if you guys know what it is.
Cherries, yeah.
Okay, I have the seed. It's something that we have a lot in Portugal and my son loves. It's like a little, it looks like a yellow tomato that has a skin outside, like a pocket. Have you ever seen? They're expensive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
Dubai.
Trader Joe's once a year for a ridiculous amount of money.
Yes.
Let me see if I find it here. Okay, then you become a crazy lady because you have a ton of seeds. You know. So let me show it to you. So this is the eggplant I was talking about. You see this eggplant? It's hard to find this one.
If you've never seen one, they do come in white, round, and that's why it's named eggplant.
Yeah, because they love like.
Yeah,
interesting. But this one, you can eat the skin, you can eat everything. Listada de Gandia, because they are, it's Spanish, that's why I love, you know, close to Portugal, that's what we eat there. And I love this eggplant in the oven, just with onions on top and salt and garlic is one of the best things. And a little bit of olive oil. That sounds what?
It sounds so good right now.
It is wonderful. So that's why I'm growing that one. Let me see here fast if I find, just to show you what the ground cherries are. It's this. So this is a very specific thing. It's like a yellow tomato.
This is excellent. It has a lot of vitamin C. It's very healthy for you. And it belongs to the same family as the tomato. So if you look at the seedling, you will see that it's full of cherries.
So what's the name of it?
Brown cherry.
Brown cherry.
Brown cherries are
and Molly stumbled.
And these are tomatoes?
No, this is a fruit.
Cherry.
No, tomato is a fruit too.
So. Cherry or sherry?
Sherry.
Yeah. It's like a really low growing bush along the ground. And they're, it's like a gooseberry. It's similar to a gooseberry, but they call them choke cherries.
So, this is the broccoli that I told you about. This broccoli and this grows like crazy. It's one of the best things. So you can buy one of the book. I have a collection.
Yes.
So, for example, these are the flowers. They look like syrup.
Yes, they do.
They are beautiful.
Yeah.
I have sunflowers. That
you
I'm growing this year, but they are 5 feet tall, so it's not like.
You completely ignored your online audience.
So we're still here.
Yeah, we're here.
I'm planting zinnias. So, if you guys want to look at my seeds, go
like,
ahead.
Tomatillos, aren't they?
Yeah, but they are a fruit. Tomatillos are, but it's you can eat like that. You just open the skin. And you try them, and they are excellent, okay? And another thing that I would like to tell you, usually you may be thinking, where do I buy my seeds from? Usually I will buy my seeds either from, at this point, either from Sprouts. They have a brand called Botanical Interests, and they are excellent. And the other place I really like is Baker Creek. It's the one that has the ground cherries. And the reason why I like Baker Creek so much, it's they have a lot of heirlooms. And every time you spend $10, they send you a free packet.
Baker Creek?
Baker Creek.
Baker Creek heirloom online.
So yes.
They send you a free catalog.
They send it, like, I love their catalog. And then I love that every time, so what I do is instead of buying $30 of seeds, I buy 10. And you don't pay shipping. So it's what the seeds cost is what you pay. And then you just play around with it. So any questions? This was my simple presentation from
awesome.
A beginner that doesn't know much.
The fish fertilizer, is that at Lowe's too?
I think I bought this on at Amazon, but you have it at Lowe's. Amazon.
What's the brand of
that one? Alaska something? Well, you guys can come and check.
Yeah, Frank just mentioned about the pilgrims and they were learning how to plant. Mm-hmm. The Indians put the fish in.
The hole.
Yeah.
It's like everything is connected. So yeah. Another thing that I tried this year.
Yeah, American Indian.
I tried for the first time potatoes from seed. You know, did you know that you can grow potatoes from seed? This is the result. Fail forward.
Hey, I'm proud of you. I never got potato seeds.
There you go.
These are potato seeds.
Wow.
How to fail. And you see that it has the hairs again? So the potatoes are the same family as the...
Well, that's impressive. Can you show it to the camera too, as if somebody is watching?
So then, for example, for my strawberries, I use this Baritone, and it's the same thing. I will use it in my azaleas. No, it's not that. We don't say it.
Azalea.
My blackberries, my gardenias, my magnolias, marigolds, so they all belong to the same family, so you can use the same. Do you have, guys have any questions?
I just found something out. So that's in Missouri, Baker Street.
Uh-huh.
We're going to be doing it, baby.
Oh, if you go there, it's beautiful. I have never been there.
Yeah, we'll send you there. You can import some.
And they have a restaurant, and they say it's amazing. It's amazing.
Okay, there's a question there.
On your Black Eyed Susan, do you know if the ones you got are vining or not?
There are two types. One are the yellow ones. Let me.
Did you plant the vining one?
Yes.
Okay, so
there she goes.
So we have, let me come here. We have these ones. These are very expensive, and these are the vine ones. They're beautiful. They go up a trellis, and they are some of the most beautiful thing. I'm not sure how this is going to end. And then you have the normal ones, which is are this. These are rudbeckias. This, and this is are the things that then you learn, and you say, wow, this is also awesome. This is, no, not this one. This, probably this one. This is all the same plant. It sounds crazy, but this is all the same plant, the same type of plant. It's all black. They are all rudbeckias, and they are perennials. Here, usually, they go for more than one year.
Can you show it to the camera, please? Thank you.
I'm a disaster.
You're awesome.
So that's it. I love dahlias. If you haven't ever planted dahlias, they are one of the most beautiful things. And I like these because usually it's tuber, but I like the seeds because it's like a surprise. You have no idea what you will get, the type. So my idea this year, and I'll ask my husband to take pictures, is to plant our raised beds and in the bark, the black bark, in the ground, all the flowers and the veggies all together. Let's see how it goes.
Oh, how fun.
So if you guys want some seeds, I don't have many, but I have peas. This is the time of the year if you want to try to go with peas, make a hole. And these are from Dr. Teske, so they are, that's another one. One day I went to his house, and when I left, I had like a seed vault. So I hate peas. I will die before I eat peas. It's the only thing in the world that...
I'm that way with Brussels sprouts. So I
okay, I hate Brussels sprouts.
You should join me.
I love Brussels sprouts and peas. But for 20 years, I haven't eaten peas.
I like snow peas. The ones that you eat, like just the... So if you guys want peas, we have bags here. They are organic, extra blessed. They came from Dr. Tex's backyard. So it's a good time. Another thing that it's a very good time. See, when you spend $10, and I'm not affiliated with them, so I don't get anything for this. They send you a free seed packet. Okay. So if you, it has like 18 seeds here. So if you wanna take, you can take some. If you want to plant tomatoes, it's going to be already a little bit late, but you have here. If you like wasabi, I wouldn't
put this. Yeah.
But if someone wants, it's all yours. I won't touch this.
Thank you. Do you like wasabi? No.
I love wasabi. Amelia likes wasabi.
So take there.
I was going to pass it to you.
There's 23 here. You guys just need one or two. Just divide between yourselves.
We were in Thailand and we were on a train and they served us a meal and they had this wasabi.
The seeds are very, very small, but they all germinate. They are awesome. It's celosia. I don't know if you guys know what celosia is. It's a beautiful flower.
Wow.
It has very small. Just search celosia on your cell phone.
Simple things to improve your health.
So, then, if you guys want a little bit of parsley, coriander, Portuguese cabbage, probably not the right time to plant, but if you guys want to take a little bit, just leave some for me and let them up. Cabbage. What?
It's kale. No, it's not kale. It's not. Collard greens.
No, it's not.
Oh, it's different from collard
greens. It's completely different. It's this.
Because like, I buy
so much
collard
for sherry.
Oh,
my delight. Yes. This is
wonderful.
This one.
Here.
You see? It's different. It's a cabbage. Yeah, but it's not.
I grew collard greens back in Long Beach in my raised bed, and my collard greens leaves were 4 feet tall.
Wow.
Well, you know what they would do is they'd go for the outside leaves, and I just left out those and let them just annihilate.
Once they sprout, I will get you one already.
I'm going to have,
I don't even know if my are going to sprout. I plant them, and they sprout.